Chapter 1. The Difference an Idea Makes. You know the difference an idea makes. You may not realize it, but if you look about you, where you work, in a large office, on an assembly line, in the government, on a salesman's beat, in a small store, in the laboratory, in the shipping room or the executive suite, you will see the difference an idea makes. You will see the difference in the men who move ahead. You will see it in the products which make sales records. You will see it in the business which prospers. You will see it in profit and loss statements, on the stock exchange, in the delicatessen which closes, in the headlines. You will see it in your home and other homes, in the family which does things, in your church and lodge, in your political party, in your government. The one quality which turns the ordinary into the extraordinary is ideas. For example, visit the engineering department of a large manufacturing company, say in the field of electronics, and you will see row upon row of drawing boards and row upon row of engineers, all in shirt sleeves, who look remarkably alike. And they have much in common. Each man in the room has an engineering degree. Each has been graduated from the company training program. Most of the men are married, have about the same number of children and the same number of bedrooms in their split-level homes. About 14 payments left on the car and 17 years left to go on their mortgage. They all get the same pay, give or take a few dollars. If you came back in a year to that vast room full of seemingly identical engineers, you would see that a strange process had taken place. One man, way back on the left, had moved his slide rule and drawing pens up to a drawing board at the front of the room. Another came in one day and sat down at a desk, not a drawing board, in an office down the corridor. Still, another apparently lost in the centre of a room full of shirt-sleeve workers, moved out to the front office and started to wear a suit jacket and carry a brown leather dispatch case to work instead of a lunchbox. This process might seem strange, mysterious, and completely non-understandable viewed from a distance. You might feel like an anthropologist on a South Sea island viewing some native rites that were unaccountable. But, if you investigated, you would find an enormous difference between the look-alike men in the look-alike shirts, in the hanger-sized workroom. The men who moved ahead had ideas. Sure, not all the ideas were good ones. Not all of them worked. Others were too expensive. Still others had tried before. But they were ideas, that ingenious, creative element, which makes all the difference in our lives. Notice I said they had ideas, not an idea, and they expressed those ideas. Actually, they had a flood of ideas, and in effect, the whole engineering department depended on the creative energies of a tiny minority. That fellow on the left was working over a drawing when he had an idea for a new material which would make a better part at less cost. The next day he worked on another part and realized that one of the manufacturing processes could be eliminated by a redesign. A fortnight later he saw how the company could save money by purchasing stock screws rather than tooling their own connections. All year long he kept seeing the same products and processes as the rest of the men in the room, but in them he saw problems, and then he thought up solutions to those problems. That man in the middle of the room lost a blueprint one day, and he figured out a coding system so plans couldn't be misplaced so easily. He had a headache and suggested better lights over the drawing boards. Loaded down with work, he devised a new method of drawing designs, trying to arrange his own vacation he came up with a better vacation schedule. During the year, his pet peeves, irritations, frustrations led to new ideas. That fellow, way back in the room, went shopping with his wife one evening and sent in new ideas on new markets for products the next morning. He met an amateur radio bug and realized how a tube his company manufactured could be adapted for ham radio use. He saw his wife make a ready-mix cake and had an idea for plastic packaging. Building a model plane with his son, he saw how one of the company's oldest products could have a new use in guided missiles. Everything he did set off a chain reaction which resulted in ideas. As the ideas from the three men came into their bosses and filtered up through the company. These men became known for their ideas. They were known as idea men, men who cared about the job, men who were thinking all the time, men you could give tough problems to and expect results. When the new jobs opened up, departments expanded, their selection was natural. Ideas set them apart from the hundreds of men who had the same advantages and disadvantages they did. Ideas made the difference in their careers. Their ideas also made the difference between the company and its competitors. It swung the balance from loss to profit, from failure to success. Some of the ideas also made the difference in the defence of the free world. For example, the Air Force needed a new radar unit for a supersonic interceptor. One of the engineers had suggested a simple product, which could easily be mass-produced. Because of his idea, their bid was by far the lowest. They got the job, and made a handsome profit. But most important, the planes got the part in a hurry. In the same way that engineers look alike, so do companies. They have huge, low plants, large parking lots, carpeted executive suites, sexy receptionists, engineers who need haircuts, sales managers who need to diet, and comptrollers who need to smile. The companies aren't the same, however, and the successful ones have ideas that make the difference. To understand the full force of ideas, you have to turn to history, but certainly not ancient history. One day in 1915, one man far down the executive ladder wrote a memo and passed it along to his boss. The man with an idea was the assistant traffic manager of the Marconi Wireless Telegraph Company. Here is his memo, which I quote in full because it is one of the most astounding documents in business history. I have in mind a plan of development which would make radio a household utility in the same sense as the piano or phonograph. The idea is to bring music into the house by wireless. While this has been tried in the past by wires, it has been a failure, because wires do not lend themselves to this scheme. With radio, however, it would seem to be entirely feasible. For example, a radio telephone transmitter, having a range of, say, 25 to 50 miles, can be installed at a fixed point, where instrumental or vocal music or both are produced. The problem of transmitting music has already been solved in principle, and therefore all receivers attuned to the transmitting wavelength should be capable of receiving such music. The receiver can be designed in the form of a simple radio music box and arranged for several different wavelengths, which should be changeable with the throwing of a single switch or pressing of a single button. The radio music box can be supplied with amplifying tubes and a loud-speaking telephone, all of which can be neatly mounted in one box. The box can be placed on a table in the parlour or living room. The switch set accordingly, and the transmitted music received. There should be no difficulty in receiving music perfectly when transmitted with a radius of 25 to 50 miles. Within such a radius, there reside hundreds of thousands of families, and, as all can simultaneously receive from a single transmitter, there would be no question of obtaining sufficiently loud signals to make the performance enjoyable. The power of the transmitter can be made 5 kilowatts if necessary, to cover even a short radius of 25 to go miles, thereby giving extra loud signals in the home if desired. The use of head telephones would be obviated by this method. The development of a small loop antenna to go with each radio music box would likewise solve the antenna problem. The same principle can be extended to numerous other fields. As for example, receiving lectures at home, which can be made perfectly audible. Also, events of national importance can be simultaneously announced and received. Baseball scores can be transmitted in the air by the use of one set installed at the polo grounds. The same would be true of other cities. This proposition would be especially interesting to farmers and others living in outlying districts removed from the cities. By the purchase of a radio music box, they could enjoy concerts, lectures, music, recitals, etc., which may be going on in the nearest city within their radius. While I have indicated a few of the most probable fields of usefulness for such a device, yet there are numerous other fields to which the principle can be extended. In connection with this idea, I have had in mind for some time the possibility of connecting up the wireless age with the plan, thereby making the wireless press a profitable venture. What I have in mind is this. Every purchaser of a radio music box would be encouraged to become a subscriber of the wireless age, which would announce in its columns an advanced monthly schedule of all lectures, music recitals, etc., to be given in the various cities of the country. With this arrangement, the owner of the radio music box can learn from the columns of the wireless age what is going on in the air at any given time, and throw the radio music box switch to the point, wavelength, corresponding with the music or lecture desired to be heard. If this plan is carried out, the volume of paid advertising that can be obtained for the wireless age on the basis of such proposed increased circulation would in itself be a profitable venture. In other words, the wireless age would perform the same mission as is now being performed by the various motion picture magazines, which enjoy so wide a circulation. The manufacture of the radio music box, including antenna, in large quantities, would make possible their sale at a moderate figure of perhaps $Y per outfit. The main revenue to be derived, which will be from the sale of radio music boxes, which, if manufactured in quantities of 100,000 or so, could yield a handsome profit when sold at the price mentioned above. Secondary sources of revenue would be from the sale of transmitters and from increased advertising and circulation of the wireless age. The company would have to undertake the arrangements, I am sure, for music recitals, lectures, etc., which arrangements can be satisfactorily worked out. It is not possible to estimate the total amount of business obtainable with this plan until it has been developed and actually tried out. But there are about 15 million families in the United States alone, and if only 1 million or 7% of the total families thought well of the idea, It would, at the figure mentioned, mean a gross business of about $75 million, which should yield considerable revenue. Aside from the profit to be derived from this proposition, the possibilities for advertising for the company are tremendous, for its name would ultimately be brought into the household, and wireless would receive national and universal attention. Like most good ideas, it seems obvious after it has become history. Yet we have to remember that in 1915, there was no broadcasting industry. Telegraphy was used for communication, not entertainment. It was a serious business. The memo was tossed aside with a laugh. For an astonishing 5 years, nothing happened. Then, the Radio Corporation of America was formed. The idea man pulled his memo out of the files and sent it along to Owen D. Young, chairman of the board of the new company. That was on January 30th. On March 3rd, the idea man was asked by E. W. Rice, Jr., president of RCA, for an estimate of future radio business. The following additional memo was written. The radio music box proposition, regarding to which I reported to Mr. Nally in 1915, and to Mr. Owen D. Young on January 31st, 1920, required considerable experimentation and development. But, having given the matter much thought, I feel confident in expressing the opinion that the problems involved can be met. With reasonable speed in design and development, a commercial product can be placed on the market within a year or so. Should this plan materialise, it would seem reasonable to expect sales of 1 million radio music boxes within a period of 3 years. Roughly estimating the selling price at $75 per set, $75 million can be expected. This may be divided approximately as follows. First year, 100,000 radio music boxes, $7.5 million. Second year, 300,000 radio music boxes, $22.5 million. Third year, 600,000 radio music boxes, $45 million. Total, $75 million. By now, you should have guessed the name of the idea. Today, he was as world famous as General David Sarnoff, chairman of the board of the Radio Corporation of America. To finish the story of this amazing memo, compare his estimates with the actual figures of the first 3 years radio music boxes were sold by RCA. Year 1, $11 million. Year 2, $22.5 million. Year 3, $50 million. Total, $83.5 million. Here was an idea that turns an assistant traffic manager into one of the most influential and wealthy men in the United States, and formed the basis of a new industry which has affected every one of us. The way we act, the way we think, the way we talk, every nook and cranny of our world, public and private, has been changed by David Sarnoff's idea and its direct descendant, television. The magic that ignited this revolution was a simple, powerful idea, and a man who had both the drive to write it down and the stubbornness to keep pushing it for the 5 years when he was ridiculed. Each one of us should understand that there is always resistance to new ideas, and not be discouraged into paralysis by it. Such inertia is natural and normal. For example, take the zipper. In 1926, a Cub advertising salesman called on the Hookless Fastener Company, known today as Talon, in Meadville, Pennsylvania. "Art," someone asked him, "how can we sell more of our zippers?" Art thought a moment, I've got an idea. Why not sell them to men's clothing manufacturers to put them on flies instead of buttons? They roared. They'd never heard anything so ridiculous. The arguments against the idea came up. The killer phrases, "That's silly. Men won't wear them. We'll run into trouble. There'll be accidents. We'll be sued." It took 4 years before they accepted the idea, which today provides a huge share of their profits. Behind each industry is a man with an idea. Before World War I, a businessman naturalist, hunting fine fox furs in Labrador, noticed that fish and game, frozen in blasts of midwinter, 40-50 degrees below zero, were more flavorful than foods frozen in spring and fall. He wondered why. To find out, he cut paper-thin slices of fish and found that the quick frozen flesh was firm, but that the slower frozen fish were grainy with large ice crystals and leaked juice when they thawed. Several years later, he happened into the wholesale fish business. "I felt Americans would eat more fish if it could be kept really fresh during shipment," he wrote years later in the Reader's Digest. "I borrowed the corner of an ice cream plant in New Jersey and started experiments in mechanical freezing. In 1923, I organized a company and the next year put quick frozen fish on the market. Soon we went broke, but my wife and I hocked our insurance and used the money to design an automatic freezer and form a new company. Eventually, I got the backing of several wealthy men. In 1929, we sold out our frozen foods business for $22 million. His name, of course, was Clarence Birdseye. And what a difference his idea is still making in every home today. It has created thousands upon thousands of jobs. People who make freezers and service them, people who raise food for freezing companies, people who pack and sell frozen foods, and people who eat them all year round. His idea has revolutionized one of the nation's basic industries. One thing we should realize, however, is the importance of small ideas and rearrangements of what we already know. Those ideas have their place just as much as the great revolutionary ideas. George J. Abrams, vice president in charge of advertising for Revlon, points out the importance of all sorts of ideas in the competitive business world. He mentions the idea of the aerosol container, which was used first with whipped cream and later shaving cream. He tells us how a small company like Breck in Springfield, Massachusetts, successfully competes with huge international firms in the creative warfare of business because of good ideas. Breck doesn't have a million-dollar TV program. It does have beauty parlors across the nation using and recommending its products because of brilliant merchandising ideas. In almost every case of profit-making products, there is a good idea behind the product. Abrams cites a competitive product which became the largest selling deodorant on the market. Why? Because it rolls on. Using the principle of a ballpoint pen, an idea which created millions upon millions of dollars of business a decade ago. His own company, Revlon, has a long record of successful ideas. One is Love Pat. For generations, women have been putting loose, messy powder onto expensive compacts. Revlon pressed powder under high pressure into expensive, but attractive plastic compacts any woman could afford. Overnight, the Love Pat compact became the largest selling item in the face powder field. "I know of no business weapon so powerful as a strong idea," concludes Abrams. There's Herbert Piker, a young Hamilton, Ohio manufacturer, who sat staring at a minnow bucket. He had inherited a metal box company, which was in bad shape. He didn't know which way to turn, but as he stared, he thought, why not put a layer of insulation between those two cans? That was the beginning of the Scotch cooler. In 4 years, his run-down business was grossing more than $5 million annually. The profit from a good idea is easy to figure, but J.A. Anderson of the AC spark plug division of General Motors has pointed out the other side of the coin. We have the cost of ideas not thought up. That is a very definite cost. We have the cost of ideas thought of too late. We have the cost of ideas not developed to their fullest potential. We have the cost of ideas not thought of at all. Ideas which people have had or not had have made the simple difference in the whole history of man. Ideas that are simple and complex ideas. Little ideas and big ideas. What unknown genius first discovered the wheel? Who was the person? Was it a woman who discovered wheat could be made into bread? Our whole world is defined by the men who had the ideas that made possible the automobile, the bridge, the skyscraper, the airplane, the ocean liner, the telephone, the light which turns night into day. Who can estimate the value of the idea of a curved axe handle, which made it possible for one man to clear more wilderness and create a new world? What price can be put on the idea of freedom that made children defy Russian tanks in Hungary in 1956? The essential difference between nations is ideas. The free world will stand or fall on the strength of our ideas. In a hell bomb age, ideas are still more powerful than any other force known to man.